There are our Twitter accounts if you want to follow us. And the presentation is part of a larger research project that we are involved in. And it's called Organizational Structures and Digital Skills Regarding OJS Adoption in Mexican Humanities Journals. Well, we want to start with some context, political and social, because we think that it's relevant to situate our object of study in a larger context. For example, I think there's a few things that are relevant to understanding where we stand. First, a global economic crisis and how it affects research policies. There have been in the States and in the EU and in Latin America measures of fiscal austerity, which has meant budget cuts in higher education and research and development. And there have been consequences, multiple consequences, but one of them is brain drain. I think we are all familiarized with that concept, but if there's not enough, in some cases, not all of the cases, but there's not enough investment in a very strong system, a research system, people with high skills and some researchers just leave their countries, and it's a very common phenomenon. So that happens if there's no political stability in countries or economic crisis. And some part of the context which is more directly involved with academic the academic ecosystem is how content and infrastructure is owned by commercial publishers. Remedios yesterday mentioned this research, but what I want to state here is that big publishers are commercial enterprises and they are driven by profit, not well-being. There are other values and principles that we don't have to forget. And there is this investigation with data for of 2013. As you can see, and maybe a lot of you are familiarized with that research, is that the profits are very high, and decisions are based on getting those profits. And also, something that also Remedios said yesterday was this research of Posada, Chen and Tang. It's about the acquisition and integration of the scholarly infrastructure by big publishers, and they're acquiring a lot of the digital tools, a lot of digital tools that are embedded in their research process. And what is the thing is that these states are the scenario where power dynamics are at play. First, for authors, there's a pressure, like the publish and perish. Yeah, this is a very good comic. You are all free to follow Pedro Mix. I think he has like an Instagram account or a Facebook one. So yeah, it's we have all felt that at some point of our career. So this is a pressure, public or perish pressure, that leaves us with no range of having a choice on to publish or not, because our career depends on these policies of what is considered valuable research. And also copyright, which John Wilinski stated on the first day at the dinner, like the on Wednesday, copyright takes what is funded by, in some cases, public research and takes it out of the public domain and encloses it. And what it does is just give it to people, like to institutions that can pay very high rates. So these are power dynamics. So if you have resources, financial resources, you can get access to some of the relevant literature. And also this produces a system which has unequal scholarly communication. The landscape is unequal. and there are some players which knowledge is considered valuable, and some other players which knowledge is not. So that's part of the context.
This is not working.
Okay. So in this context, PKP is being very hands-on the community building process. And we highlighted some of the words and concepts that we think are relevant. For example, diversity, values and principles are being guiding PKP for since it was born, and it's also one of the, how can I say, like lines and dimensions that have been covering this conference. So it's tech, community, OA, and one of them we think it's very important to celebrate diversity, also make the knowledge public, and make this like the concept of public good, and turning aiming to a global scale. We think that it's important and very valuable for countries like Mexico, where we focus our research.
Well, for the Mexican case, according to Latindex, there are around 450 journals, open access journals. They are published by scholarly institutions like universities, research centers, scholarly and scholarly associations. These journals are funded directly or indirectly by the federal government or the state level government. And of these journals, 131 using OJS. Well, so our research question is, what is the process of socio-technical appropriation of an open technology, the OJS, in editorial teams of humanities journals in Mexico? Our theoretical framework focus on science and technology and society studies, STS, with two perspectives. The first of philosophy of technology with Landon Wiener, who says that from its design, the technological artifacts have a political dimension that allows to configure or change practice of daily life. Also, technology and society are in constant process of co-production. The second perspective is the history of technology with Thomas Hughes, that says, that the implementation of any technology is the product of technical, social, material, legal, political, organizational, cognitive relationships, and these dimensions form a socio-technical system or our technological system. Hughes says that when a technology stabilizes, its use within social groups and in time and space, it achieves a technological momentum.
So how did we do what we did? Well, we assembled our 10 Mexican humanities journals. 5 of them are from the discipline of philosophy, 3 of them from history, and 2 of from linguistics. All of them use OJS as a publication platform, and as we could see in the previous slide, it's a very important platform in Mexico. We conducted extensive interviews with academic and executive editors, so we did we conceptualized this difference between editors. One of them handles the peer review assignments, and the other one just is in charge of the technical procedures. And the thing is that in some journals, there are not two people, just like the academic editor has to take care of all of that. So it's not the regular way of doing it, but in some cases it's completely necessary because the academic editor just can't do that, cover all of those tasks anymore. So our interviews had four dimensions, and one of them was focus on the editorial process, And from that, they mentioned OJS along the interview, like in a lot of points, like a lot of moments, sorry, of the interview. But we had three specific questions regarding the editorial flow, description and challenges around the editorial flow, and also description and analysis or challenges around editorial stuff. So those were the questions that were mainly aiming to OJS. So,
yeah. Well, this is our first result, that this slide shows the actors inside of what we called the technological system or socio-technical system of scholarly communication in Mexico for the part of edition. And we divide in three types of actors. The first are scientific actors, like authors, directors, reviewers, readers, researchers, committees, theories, and investigation programs. The second group is technical actors, like editorial assistants, staff, designers, computer managers, style editors, and software and hardware, like operational systems, the editorial space, like office, and editorial policies. The third group is are organizational actors that are external. Are scientific policy, the databases, institutional policies, policies and organizational conditions, companies specialized in computing, libraries, printers, departments of publication, and trade unions. All of these actors are around of the journal with social division of labor, financial and material resources, technical and epistemic practice around the journal, representations and translation of technology, and different degrees of interaction. Well, this slide proves like how the Council of Science supports the implementation of OJS with different strategies and UNAM. The next one, please. The National University of Mexico, the UNAM, the UNAM también also support the implementation of open journal systems. Next one.
So we could. So this is the OJS editorial and publishing process, and we can see that like this was the ideal workflow, but we identified, like by identifying the actors and the editorial process, in, as you can see, in some aspects, for example, in submission, the submission queue, the journal management, the review, the layout, they don't use OJS when performing those tasks, or they use it partially. And as you can see, the journal manager and like the third column is where the tensions are very present. So sometimes you have to deal with reviewers that are older and don't want to adapt the technology, and or sometimes the editors do that, so they tend to use email or like one-to-one interaction, or maybe even like paper to do it. So because all communities and also people are different, they adapt the OJS process.
Well, this slide represent the actors have a direct relationship with the OJS, with the tool. And the slide present bar put scientific actors, three authors, reviewers, readers, and technical actors, and organizational actors.
So, well, because we don't have that much time, these are a few extracts, I don't know, of the interviews. So some of them, they say, okay, we're using OJS for everything that we do, and some experience is that it's complicated because OJS doesn't work in our server, so we have to do everything by email, or problems with the mailing system, which it goes to spam. So those are their voices, but we will have this available if you want to read it more, but now, because of time, we can't read all of the extracts, you know. So, in conclusion, we have to say that we think that in STS and in general, we have to look at a wider political and economical context in which every digital tool is being used. There are people involved which have different degrees of knowledge, and also that it's important to understand how much a technology can be adapted or how it will be used. In some cases, OGS, for some editors, they see it as the panacea. It was a golden standard. They wanted, so a common statement was like, well, when we use OGS all the way, like all the parts of this tool, and they were aiming to do that, but because different actors have different knowledge or abilities regarding digital tools, they couldn't get to that point, but it seemed like a golden standard. And that's also very, at least we consider it interesting. Also, we identified a point of tension. It's, well, if we consider OGS and like the political stance of the words that we saw when we were thinking about how OGS builds a community, there we highlighted a few words. So making open access, publishing a viable option, public good, global scale. And the thing is, we identified these some external organizational, external actors. So in some cases, they could be service providers. And the thing is that these service providers, sometimes they are hired directly by the university or the institution. And sometimes they're public goods that go into these external actors that are small enterprises, but they work for profit. So we see a tension between this discourse of public good and when this platform is the occupation of this platform has to relate with these for profit enterprises. So we think that there are a few questions that need to be asked. So maybe we can debate them now, or we just like wanted to put it there in order for you to like go to other presentations or to your houses if you can or want to reflect on them. So what is the process of appropriation of an open technology in contexts where knowledge production is being practiced? How do you establish a dialogue with neoliberal process of knowledge production? So we identify this neoliberal process of knowledge production as the privatization and outsourcing of services. And also, I wanted to take this opportunity to expose what is happening in my country, Chile. I think that you should be aware that since October 18th, we are in a fight for basic social rights, and they have been brutal repression. Our president haven't heard any like Amnesty International. They made a report that the repression was brutal. That police wanted to, they were attacking people, and they were they're actually shooting people in the eye, so mutilation is a way of quiet down the right to protest. So these are some numbers. There have been people that have been dead. There have been military in the streets, and the police is acting brutally. So I just wanted to show that what can happen when neoliberal processes are in the wild, because the state has no regulation over this. And the things that people in Chile, we don't have the basic pensions, health, or education covered. So I just want you to be aware of what can happen when the state are not thinking about the public good. So thank you.